Bonsoir à tous. Good evening, everyone. And thank you for joining us for the Ontario College of Teachers 2020 annual virtual meeting of members. My name is Chantal Bellil, and I'm the Deputy Registrar. I'd like to begin by acknowledging that at the college, the land on which we gather is the traditional territory of the Wendat, the Anishinaabe, the Haudenosaunee, the Métis, and the Mississaugas of the Credit First Nation. You've most likely taken note of our agenda. We hope to stay the course with our proposed timeline. During this evening's session, we will be hearing from the Chair of our Discipline Committee, John Hamilton, the Chair of our Governance Committee, Tom Potter, the Chair of our Standards of Practice and Education Committee, Marianne Mawad. Without further delay, I'd like to introduce our Chair of Council, Nicole Van Wittenberg.
Thank you for that. Good evening, everyone, et bonsoir. I'm Nicole Van Wittenberg, and I'm the Chair of College Council. Thank you for attending our annual meeting of members. We recognize the ongoing challenges you may be facing with the pandemic and thank members for their continued professionalism in educating Ontario students. I'm pleased to report on Council's activities from last year. Strengthening transparency and accountability. Managing risk more strategically. Improving stakeholder engagement. These are the college's strategic priorities, and these priorities serve as a foundation that help us govern the profession of teaching in Ontario. Once again, in 2019, they continue to be clearly tied to our public interest mandate and the goal of fostering public confidence and trust. You will agree that nothing is more important than the safety and well-being of Ontario students. Legislative change, such as the therapy and counseling funding, which was passed in 2019 and came into effect January 1st, 2020, is one such example. Council passed many motions that enhanced the transparency of the functioning of the organization to its members and the public. For example, the policy review cycle foregrounds the importance of cyclical review of all policies to ensure they adhere to the Ontario College of Teachers Act, regulations, and bylaws. All of them govern our organization. In April 2019, Bill 48, which included governance changes to the Act, received royal assent. The many related motions passed by Council were communicated to the Ministry of Education. These Council directives provide the Ministry with clear information of what the Governing Council believes allow for transparent, robust governance to self-regulate the teaching profession in Ontario. In the summer of 2019, the College held focus group sessions with College members and the public. We conducted these sessions to gauge opinions on a number of college initiatives and communication products. For example, we discussed the college governance structure and preferred topics for future professional advisories. Nous avons to
These sessions were held in English and French in Windsor, Welland, Ottawa, Barrie, Thunder Bay, and Toronto. These cities were chosen to reflect different geographic regions, demographics, and of course, spoken languages.
Feedback helps the college's governing council and staff act with increased efficiency. We were delighted to recognize three accomplished and impressive teacher candidates with our annual Ontario College of Teachers Scholarship Program. Mia Kakabeek was the recipient of the Joseph W. Atkinson Scholarship for Excellence in Teacher Education. A little background on Mia. She is known to live her life with passion and purpose. She aims to make students feel strong and unstoppable so that they can unleash their best and most authentic self. She teaches what we could all remember for ourselves. Failure is a stepping stone to success. For her, failure refines us. It doesn't define us. We also recognize Fatima Ahmed, the recipient of the Ontario College of Teachers Primary Junior or Junior Intermediate Scholarship. With her degree in Peace and Conflict Studies, she has left her mark around the world as she gained work experience in the Canadian Arctic, Southern Africa, South Pacific, and in multiple rural and urban areas within Canada and the US. Our third finalist, Jordan Cascanet, is the recipient of the Ontario College of Teachers Intermediate Senior Scholarship. Jordan has a reputation for being patient, personable, caring, and hardworking. Those who concluded their distinguished service with us on Council in 2019 include appointed members Jean-Luc Bernard in July and Rona Warsh in May, as well as elected member Shannon Marcus in August and Alicia Nunn in October. Those who began their Council term in 2019 include appointed members John Camerata in October, Wanda Percival in December, and elected members Nancy Saunders, who joined us in May, as well as Timothy Kiłkowski and Jennifer Wyatt, who joined us in December. We are grateful for the dedication and contributions of those who left and welcome our new colleagues. The 37-member Council understands the privilege of self-regulation and governs in the public interest. This is done with the utmost transparency and accountability, making decisions that set the direction for the teaching profession in Ontario. I would like to take this opportunity to give a heartfelt thanks to all those individuals who exemplify the ethical standards of respect, integrity, care, and trust in their work at the college. And let me conclude by saying that council members and staff are highly dedicated to the mandate of the college. I extend my sincere gratitude for everyone's professionalism and collaborative efforts. We continue to serve in the public interest and set the direction for the teaching profession in Ontario. Thank you et merci. And I'll pass it back to Chantel.
Thank you for sharing your report, Nicole. As mentioned, we'll now hear from the chairs of the Discipline Committee, the Governance Committee, and the Standards of Education, Practice and Education Committees. So I'd like to first welcome John Hamilton, Chair of the Discipline Committee. John, please start us off.
Wanda Percival, Tom Potter, Nicolo Powadiak, Jonathan Rose, Nancy Saunders, and Stefan Vallée. Forgive me if you missed my first introduction. Just very quickly, my name is John Hamilton, and I am an elementary principal with the Durham District School Board and chair of the Discipline Committee. Our committee is one of three committees that share the responsibility of disposing of complaints of professional misconduct against teachers and school administrators. I will briefly explain the difference between the three. The investigation committee screens all complaints and determines how the complaints will be directed. That is, either they will be directed to the discipline committee or the fitness to practice committee. The discipline committee holds hearings, which are open to the public and related to the allegations of professional misconduct or incompetence. The Fitness to Practice Committee holds hearings related to allegations of incapacity. The college receives roughly 1,500 expressions of concern about college members annually from employers, members of the public, and the profession. About half of those are resolved at the school or the local school board level. The remaining half represent formal complaints. Almost half of those, 45%, are resolved at the intake stage, while the rest are dealt with by the panel of the investigation committee. In 2019, the investigation committee disposed of 412 complaints, and the discipline committee and the fitness to practice committees disposed of 115 matters. Our committee, the discipline committee, considers matters referred to it by the investigation committee and on occasion from the executive committee. Three-member panels, that is three folks sit on each panel. Three-member panels of elected and appointed council members preside over public hearings into cases of alleged incompetence or professional misconduct. In findings of professional misconduct, the committee may recommend a member's certificate be revoked, suspended, and/or made subject to terms, conditions, or limitations, which may include appropriate coursework, for example, professional boundaries. The DC committee may also reprimand, admonish, or counsel the member, impose a fine, and order the member to pay costs. The outcomes of the discipline committee's decisions are published in the Governing Ourselves section of Professionally Speaking, Pour Parler Profession, and on the college's website. At this point, I would like to hand the presentation over to Mr. Tom Potter, who is the chair of our governance committee. Thank you very kindly.
Thank you, John. Good evening and bonsoir to Ontario's certified teachers. My name is Tom Potter, and I'm the chair of the governance committee. I am an appointed member, but I started my career as a teacher before I moved to the pharmaceutical industry, where I held several positions in sales, marketing, and human resources. Most recently, I served as an independent consultant specializing in organizational development with a focus on recruitment, performance management, and talent management. I was first appointed to the College Council in 2015. The Governance Committee includes council members Irene Dembeck, Richard Fillion, Tim Gernstein, John Hamilton, Sarah Nuini, and Jonathan Rose. The Governance Committee is a special committee of council focused on council governance, council and committee membership, and the election of council members. And it offers guidance on governance issues such as risk assessment, council member role expectations, competency development, succession planning, and transition effectiveness. We've had a very busy 2019, and the committee spent much of its time focusing on the 37 recommendations stemming from the independent review of college governance. Council considered these recommendations that affect the Ontario College of Teachers Act, its regulations, college bylaws and policies, and has recommended amendments to the College's Act to the Minister of Education. I will highlight seven of the most significant of the 37 recommendations. These are, number one, reducing the composition of council from 37 to 18 members. Two, establishing a council with an equal number of members from the profession and appointed members. Three, establishing a selection process for council members, both professional and appointed. Four, establishing statutory, regulatory, and the standards of practice and education committees, which are populated with individuals selected by the same process as council members are. Five, ensuring equal representation on professional and public members on each statutory committee. Six, establishing staggered three-year terms for council and committee members, renewable up to one time to a maximum of 6 years. And seven, establishing two-year renewable terms for council and committee chair positions. In April of 2019, the Safe and Supportive Classrooms Act passed into law and introduced a number of amendments to the Colleges Act. Your council has shared all of its recommendations with the government and is waiting for two amendments to the Act to facilitate the governance changes. The amendments did not specify a particular selection process, nor did it provide for the formation of committees with individuals other than council members. In the absence of changes to the Act, the committee continues to provide advice to the council. With council approval of a renewed governance framework, the governance committee began to further define what the elements of a new framework might entail. And based on our committee's recommendations, council has approved a sortition process, which is the use of random selection to invite members of the profession to express their willingness to serve on council. Council also approved a similar application process recommendation by the committee for non-council member committees based on a competency profile. Our committee ended the year by engaging an external facilitator to help development of a competency profile and rubric for use with the sortition and application process. And I'm now pleased to introduce the chair of the Standards and Practice and Education Committee, Ms. Marianne Mouad. Marianne, please.
Good evening et bonsoir. I'm Marianne Mouad, acting chair of the Standards of Practice and Education Committee. I've taught for the Greater Essex County District School Board since 2002, and was elected to the 8th College Council on July the 1st, 2018. I've taught, the current committee also includes elected members, Charles Dimitri Abraham, Aaron Glenn, Ellen Gucciardi, Stephen Zimmerman, and appointed members, Elizabeth Edgar Webb-Camigad, Colleen Landers, Bonnie Oakes, Sharon, and Wanda Percival. The ethical standards for the teaching profession, the standards of practice for the teaching profession, and the professional learning framework for the teaching profession together convey a collective vision of teacher professionalism in Ontario. This collective vision is the foundation of teacher education, professional practice, ongoing professional learning, and educational leadership. The College's Standards of Practice and Education Committee advises the College Council on the development, implementation, and review of the ethical standards, the standards of practice, and the professional learning framework. Our committee also reviews and approves additional qualification policy guidelines and associated research. Additional qualification, or AQ, courses are offered by approved providers across Ontario. AQ policy guidelines issued by the college provide the framework for these courses. Our committee supports the development of these AQ policy guidelines by engaging with educators, learners, AQ providers, educational partners, and the public. This collaborative process is essential to ensure AQ guidelines reflect current practices, foster the exploration of innovation, adopt an anti-oppressive stance, and align with emerging practices in education. As well, the college uses inclusive practices to invite shared leadership and ownership in the AQ review process. In 2019, the committee approved 26 draft AQ course guidelines. Also in 2019, the Standards of Practice and Education Committee received input from 12 AQ provincial writing team sessions for the development or revision of 44 AQ course guidelines. Over the course of the year, the committee developed 5 written reports regarding policy development, research, and the standards-based educative work of the committee. During the year, our committee collected important data through surveys of 1,758 AQ course candidates. This information is used to guide and inform the AQ policy development and accreditation practices. Every year, Standards of Practice and Education staff facilitate sessions related to teacher education, ethical practice, and leadership development. In 2019, staff facilitated 62 sessions, supporting close to 2,000 participants. This included teacher candidates, new teachers, teacher educators, teacher leaders, principal candidates, and AQ course developers, as well as internationally educated teachers. Also in 2019, the Standards of Practice and Education Committee supported the development of standards-based educative resources to support teacher education and professional practice. The Standards of Practice staff collaborated with AQ course designers and instructors to develop a digital resource called Intentional Design AQ Courses. The goal of this new resource is to help AQ course designers and instructors embed an anti-oppressive stance within all AQ courses. It is our committee's belief that this resource will be beneficial for initial and professional practice as well. And finally, we are pleased to share a new resource developed by a college member from Six Nations entitled A Rotenoshani Representation of the Ethical Standards for the Teaching Profession that depict the ethical standards being artistically represented through a Rotenoshani cultural perspective. Thank you.
Thank you, Marianne. I would like to introduce the college's deputy registrar, Chantal Bellio.
Thank you, Nicole. As many of you, I'm also one of the 234,000 proud Ontario certified teachers. The college issues licenses so educators may work in Ontario's publicly funded schools. In addition to licensing educators, the college also sets the ethical standards and the standards of practice for the teaching profession. We investigate and resolve complaints about members, and we accredit teacher education programs and courses. In the next few minutes, I'd like to provide a quick overview of some of our accomplishments in 2019. If you'd like to learn more, please see the full annual report on our website, oct.ca. Pour en connaître davantage, s'il vous plaît.
If you'd like to know more, please see the full annual report on our website at oct.ca.
Our work in 2019 began late in 2018 as we reset our strategic focus. At our council's direction, we moved to strengthen transparency and accountability, manage risk more strategically, and improve our engagement with stakeholders. In the interest of transparency, we made it a priority to speak plainly in our conversations, our website, our magazine and documents, in our dialogue with members, and with the public. We updated our mobile app to make it easier for our members to access information and resources. At the same time, we discontinued our annual renewal print package, this saving money as well as the environment. In the summer of 2019, we hosted focus groups across Ontario to gather public and professional opinion on everything from how the college is governed to topics for future professional advisories. In response, we updated our professional advisory about professional misconduct of a sexual nature and created audio versions in English and French of all existing advisories. We also visited 7 Ontario communities to share advice about supporting students' mental health, along with mailing that advice directly with our quarterly magazine, Professionally Speaking, Pour Parler Profession, to all of the 234,000 members. This year, we've provided advice about video conferencing to members having to teach from home for the very first time during this pandemic. We've also been busy developing an advisory for members about professional boundaries. However, returning to 2019, For those learning to become teachers, we updated our Essential Advice to the Teaching Profession document and produced two guides to explain the registration's appeals process to college applicants. We visited Ontario's Faculties of Education to help teacher candidates understand the role and responsibilities of the college, the privilege of self-regulation, and how to register. Nous avons traduit tous les documents nécessaires.
We translated all documents required for the review of French language professional education programs, and we developed a system to quantify our work with accreditation providers.
When the provincial government introduced a mathematics proficiency test as a condition of certification, the college worked to help applicants understand the requirements. After all, it's the college's responsibility to set and administer procedures to certify Ontario teachers and to demonstrate to the public the high level of preparation of Ontario teachers. Public accountability is foundational to professional regulation. With respect to managing risk, the college commissioned a comprehensive review of our governance structure to consider contemporary practices and possible enhancements, as previously mentioned by Tom, the chair of the governance committee. What we learned will help to inform our way forward. We share this information openly with members and other interested regulators. Our investigations and hearings processes are also guided by the principles of risk mitigation and harm reduction. To support our disciplinary, corporate, and registration processes, we conducted a detailed review of our legal needs and providers. To improve accountability, we developed a method to track discipline committee orders that impose costs and fines. To inspire public confidence, we automated our system to ensure timely disposal of hearing notices and leading to timely outcomes while striving for administrative fairness to our members. We examined how incidents of alleged professional misconduct or incompetence were being reported, and we reached out to directors of education across Ontario to discuss how this information might be used to protect students. To further assist students, we created a program to provide financial help to students who have been sexually abused or involved in child pornography while under the care of an Ontario certified teacher. The program provides funding to help pay for therapy or counseling. What we learn, we share with others. For example, last October, the college hosted Ontario regulators in a discussion about best practices and challenges in receiving and managing complaints about members. With our members' help, we began to develop standards-based teacher education resources on everything from environmental stewardship and ecological literacy to fostering cultures of well-being within professional practice. Principles of inclusivity and fairness and a long-standing commitment to anti-oppression and equity are central to our work. We have developed and continue to develop additional qualification guidelines that celebrate difference and confront systemic obstacles such as anti-Black racism to the success of all students. To support Indigenous education, the college developed representations of ethical standards with a Mohawk artist and linguist from Six Nations of the Grand River. We co-presented those images at the Canadian Network of Agencies for Regulation's 2019 conference entitled Collaboration That Honors Truth and Reconciliation Within a Regulatory Context. And in partnership with the Canadian National Institute for the Blind, we produced the ethical standards for the profession and the standards of practice for the teaching profession in Braille in both English and French. In the digital realm, we ran a week-long social media campaign around World Teachers' Day to leverage the deep personal associations many people feel towards their most influential teachers. And I'm pleased to share that almost 1.5 million people saw the digital ads. Our role and our work continues to attract interest abroad. Throughout the year, we met with staff from principal associations and teacher federations and hosted delegations from countries such as Australia, the Republic of Korea, the People's Republic of China, and the Netherlands. We met with pre-service teacher education institutions from England, Scotland, Wales, and the United States.
And we spoke with dignitaries such as Quebec's Minister of Education.
Transparency, risk mitigation, accountability, and collegiality. La transparence, l'atténuation.
Transparency, risk mitigation, accountability, and collegiality.
Those are fundamental to our work to keep Ontario students safe and achieving. On behalf of our council, our senior leadership team, our staff, our partners in education and self-regulation, I thank you for listening, and I look forward to our continued work together in the public interest. So that concludes my report. However, Nicole and I would like to take some time to answer questions that have been asked by our members. And in that regard, just wanting to thank everyone for the numerous questions that were forwarded before the annual meeting of members that very much facilitated our task in being able to prepare to respond. We, however, want to say don't stop, continue sending your questions. What we can't respond to today at the annual meeting will be captured, just as all the previous questions were captured and posted to our website. And I'll repeat this again at the end. So to field one of our first questions, it was indeed asking, where did my questions go? Are they deleted? Are they being hidden? So we did have a bit of a glitch at the onset of our preparation to receive questions. However, have no fear, we were able to track them. We collated them. We'll be responding to many of them this evening. And whatever we don't respond to will be on our website, we hope within 10 business days of the annual meeting of members. Another question we received, will the annual meeting of members be done virtually in the future, as many of the college's teachers are not able to travel to Toronto for meetings? It would be more inclusive to include perspectives outside the GTA on a regular basis. So thank you for the question. We're always interested in engaging with our members. While this is our first virtual annual meeting of members, since 2017, we have been live streaming the meeting to allow for remote participation and also to collect questions from our membership. C'est une très bonne question, merci. Nous cherchons toujours à établir des liens.
That's a very good question. We're always interested in engaging more with our members. This is the first time that we have a fully online annual meeting of members, but we have live streamed the event since 2017 in order to have more participation from members who are not in the Toronto region. So please keep sending your questions.
There's only 20 minutes allowed in the agenda for responding to the college's members' questions. Why are you all not listening and respecting our voices? So in fact, when you do, as any agenda setting, you allot a certain amount of time. But however, we're ahead of schedule, so we have 30 minutes to try and get to as many questions as we can that you've sent. If you have any additional questions, you can continue forwarding them. And a couple of additional questions before I send it off to the chair for some governance related questions. Will the college provide a translation of the meeting documents in more than one white language you all focus on? Will it be translated into Indigenous languages to help with true reconciliation? So by law, the college must provide the materials in English and French. However, we have shared your requests with our governing council. Is the college, or if the college accepts COVID assistance, why is this the case if your revenue has not changed from year to year? Or are teachers going to get a discount in the future? Another question in relation to that, is the college going to give members a reduced rate for membership in 2021 due to the COVID-19 disruptions? So the Ontario College of Teachers is not requesting or receiving financial assistance from the government. Since March, the college's focus has been on supporting Ontario certified teachers through COVID-19, while continuing our commitment to regulating the profession in the public interest. Some initiatives that we undertook were delaying the payment of the 2020 membership fee from April 1 to September 30th, as well as temporarily suspending our reinstatement fee and continuing the maintenance of the membership status in good standing. The annual membership fee for 2020 will remain at $170. Every December, our college will, which is comprised of elected as well as appointed members, reviews and considers a budget for approval that's based on operational needs and prudent and responsible financial planning. So with that, I'll send it over to the chair for some governance related questions.
Thanks, Chantel. And thank you to all members who sent questions in. And as Chantel has indicated, we'll try to get to as many as possible. So a question that was posed, and thank you for this, why is there not a committee on racism, marginalized voices in education and the teaching profession? So very timely question. The college is committed to anti-oppression, diversity, and inclusion. And we recognize that there is always more work to be done and are committed to doing more, including continuing to develop our own awareness, leading where appropriate, and consulting or following as needed to support anti-oppression and anti-racist practices, policies, and processes. There are statutory, special, standing, and regulatory committees of council, as well as ad hoc committees as needed. And so we take your feedback and we will share that with council for further consideration. The next question asks, why is there not an Indigenous position in the system positions on the college's council? Publicly funded Indigenous schools should not be treated differently than publicly funded English, Catholic, French schools. So thank you for that question. And by law, our council must have at least one member of Indigenous origin to represent the public interest and interests of the education community. Council made this request for inclusion to the government back in December of 2011, and the regulation governing council appointments was changed accordingly. So as mentioned, council is highly committed to anti-oppression, diversity, and inclusion. So we encourage all Ontario certified teachers to learn more about council and either seek a position themselves or nominate a colleague. Our next question is along the same theme. Does the makeup of the Council for the Ontario College of Teachers represent the diversity of Ontario? Is there adequate representation of minorities? Not just French, Canadian, but Black, Indigenous, visible minorities, those with different abilities. So thank you for that very inclusive question. Ontario legislation defines council's composition. This includes the number of appointed and elected positions, regional representation, and qualifications. Our election system is based on regional representation and categories that reflect Ontario's publicly funded school system. And again, I can't emphasize enough that council is highly committed to anti-oppression, diversity, and inclusion. And we encourage all those Ontario certified teachers to learn more about council. And at this very timely intersection of the election being called, to either seek a position themselves or nominate a colleague. And I'll answer two more questions before I pass it back to Chantel. Why is there an education bias in the members of the council? How can it be representative of Ontario if it only includes those who have post-secondary education? This is systemic discrimination. So thank you for that question. The college and its council are committed again to the anti-oppression, diversity, and inclusion. Our council consists of both elected and publicly appointed positions. By law, the elected council members must be Ontario certified teachers and members of the teaching profession. Those are those 23 positions currently on council of the 37 members. The publicly appointed council members, of which there are 14 positions, are chosen by the provincial government and may or may not include an education requirement. If you're interested in knowing more about those requirements for public appointees, you can visit the government website where those requirements are explained. And I'll do one more question before I pass it to Chantel. How come there is not a student voice on the college's council? Leaving the students out of the picture appears to be a purposeful way to marginalize their voices and opinions. Does the age demographics of the council reflect Ontario as a whole? And thank you so much. I really admire individuals asking these questions that we are able to share information with you back with regards to council's composition as currently in the legislation. So again, our council consists of both elected and publicly appointed positions. I indicated that there are 23 elected positions and 14 appointed positions currently. And all 37 members of council serve the public interest and put it first over any other interest or affiliations. And in fact, they each council member takes an oath or gives an affirmation to that effect. And by law, elected council members must be Ontario certified teachers and members of the teaching profession. And as I've previously indicated, publicly appointed council members are chosen by the provincial government, and the government website would articulate the requirements for serving as an appointed member. And I will pass it back to Chantel at this point.
Thank you, Nicole. I'll answer a few questions we received relating to certification. So one of the questions we received, I know somebody who has a master's degree in education qualified to teach throughout the work, including Canada, but is not able to be qualified by the college because you demand a form to be filled by an organization that no longer exists. Why are you discriminating against immigrants? So we are committed to a fair, equitable, and transparent application process. The documents that we do require or request are required through the process to determine whether applicants meet all of the requirements that are listed in legislation. However, we recognize this can be a very challenging process. And in your friend's case, if the organization no longer exists, it poses even an additional layer of challenge. So in these types of cases, please, there's other alternative ways to complete the application requirements. Please have your friend reach out to the college. We'll direct them to our client services team. And the number they can call is the 416-961-8800. Another certification question. I had registered myself in 2018 for an Ontario certified teacher. I'm in the process of sending documents required to complete the licensing from my native country. Due to present scenario, institutions and universities are unlocking now, so it might take longer duration than 2 years to complete it. So thank you for letting us know. Again, to discuss the specific challenge, please don't hesitate and contact our client services team at the college number. Another question we receive relating to certification. I may, after this question, pass it on to Nicole and I'll jump into a different topic. Hi, my question is, why am I getting invitation for members meeting when my documents are under evaluation for the past 7 or 8 months? I need to get a job and I can't move forward because of your slow process. So our annual meeting of members is open to all education stakeholders, including members of the public as well as applicants. With regard to your application, please don't hesitate. Once again, call our client services team to request any updates or assistance that may be required. Again, I'll just repeat the number, 416-961-8800. Nicole?
Thank you. And I'm continuing on with this governance theme, and there's interest in council composition. Do you get paid to sit on council for the college? So thank you for that question. I want to explain a little bit that there are officers of council. So the chair and the vice chair, along with the registrar and the deputy registrar, are officers of council. Council consists of 37 members. The chair of council is full-time and receives a salary. The chair is responsible for representing council publicly and presiding over council and executive committee meetings. The role is a seconda position and is only valid for the duration of each of council's term. Now, all other council members take on their roles in the spirit of public service and do not receive any compensation outside of their regular employment. However, the college does reimburse and provide honorariums for elected members. Further, if an elected council member is on leave of absence to attend a council or committee meeting, the college will reimburse their employer for the salary expenses incurred in the hiring of an occasional teacher. So the college also reimburses members for expenses such as travel accommodations and meals incurred during college-related business. And just to be clear, the provincial government is responsible for reimbursing the appointed members. And you can find that information on the government website. So the next question, how does the college ensure the presence of teachers with an immigrant background is on the committee, especially Black teachers and other minorities? Now, this question was originally asked in French, so I will do my best to respond to it in French.
The question is, how does the college ensure the presence of teachers with an immigrant background on the committees, especially Black teachers and other minorities? Our election system is based on regional representation and categories that reflect Ontario's publicly funded school systems. The Council is highly committed to anti-oppression, diversity, and inclusion. We encourage all Ontario certified teachers to learn more about Council and seek a position themselves or to nominate a colleague.
And I will answer two more questions before I pass it back to Chantal. How come I just learned that the college represents teachers in other provinces and the council is designed to reflect this? So just to clarify, there are college members who live or work outside of Ontario and Canada, meaning they're members of the college, they're members in good standing, they're members Ontario certified teachers, but live or work outside of Ontario and Canada. Our election system is based on regional representation and categories that reflect Ontario's publicly funded school system. So we can confirm that all council members reside in Ontario. That's a requirement by law. So in-depth information about our election process is available in the September 2020 issue of Professionally Speaking. And of course, all the information is available at our website, oct.ca, and I encourage you to explore. So my last question before, I'll squeeze in two more, Chantal. I'm sure you don't mind me doing that. No. So these are questions in relation to a recent announcement of the resignation of our current registrar, Michael Salvatore. So who's going to replace Michael Salvatore as the chief electoral officer in the upcoming college election? This should have been addressed in the resignation statement. It is not being transparent to hide this critical issue. I doubt that a new registrar will be hired and up to the job if you are just starting to develop the search criteria 6 months before the election, unless you want to create confusion in the election like, quote, our friend, unquote, Trump. If you are doing a great job. So just to be clear, there is a legislation in place to cover this exact scenario because council has the power to appoint one or more deputy registrars who shall have the powers of the registrar for the purposes of the Ontario College of Teachers Act. So this includes the registrar's role for administering the council election, and those powers have been delegated to our current deputy registrar. And just because it's on the same theme in relation to the registrar, Chantal, I'll just respond to this question before passing it to you. Will the registrar and chief executive officer of the college be split into two different jobs, or is it just in place so the position sounds nicer? So really thank you for that question because it allows me to express that the act actually states that the registrar shall be the chief executive officer of the college. So that's enshrined in the Ontario College of Teachers Act. Hence, when council is discussing recruitment at their October meeting, they recognize the position of the register as per the act. And without further ado, I'll pass it back to you, Chantal.
Thank you, Nicole. I think I'm frozen. I'll keep going here just in case. So we received a question relating to the Enhanced Teacher Education Program. It has been a few years since the two-year B.Ed. Has been implemented. Is there any proof that the two-year program has better outcomes to the teaching field? Has there been a report or study on this? So thank you for the question. We do have our transition to teaching study. It provides some early insight into the outcomes of the Enhanced Teacher Education program, which saw teacher education move from a two-semester format to a four-semester format. So the 2018 transition to teaching study reached out to the first set of graduates and asked them to rate the different aspects of their teacher education program. Generally, the graduates rated their programs as positive in most areas with excellent in other areas. We also conducted the transition to teaching study in 2019, and the findings again confirmed what the previous candidates had stated, as well as the trends in Ontario job opportunities for early career teachers. So full copies of those reports are available on our website, oct.ca. I have a question on employment opportunities. The question, as a Muslim teacher, I suffered not being visible to schools. I am now an education consultant in the Middle East. I am afraid I have to be a supply teacher again if I want to come back home. Will you please make hiring easy and a cleaner process without prejudice? So thank you very much. Your question is very timely. Although hiring issues are the responsibility of the government as well as individual school boards, they fall outside of our jurisdiction. Generally speaking, though, if you are a member of the college and you've let your membership lapse, we can reinstate you. So please don't hesitate to reach out to us to confirm how that can occur. I must, and I believe our stakeholders would want me to share, as well as the Ontario government, that we're currently experiencing a shortage of certified teachers. So you are needed. The issue's been magnified because of the smaller class sizes due to the pandemic and trying to improve on social or physical distancing for students. So please, again, I'm reiterating, you are needed. Your expertise, your skill set are needed. So again, don't hesitate to call us, the college, if you would like more information about reinstating your certificate. And contact the Ministry of Education, the government, and various employers to find out any employment opportunities that may exist. I have a question relating to additional basic qualifications. I'll probably ask that one and then send it back to the chair. How can the college approve an AQ on information technology that has the participants read an article about information technology written before the iPhone and YouTube were created? This lack of oversight on this issue reduces the quality and respectability of all the college's approved AQs, ABQs. So thank you for sharing your thoughts. I regret that it seems to overarch all of the work done in ABQs and AQs and your perspective. Your feedback has been shared with our relevant college team. But if you would like to provide more feedback in that regard, again, please contact our client services team at the number I previously provided. I'll share it again, 416-961-8800. And you can provide further feedback. Anyone who wishes to provide feedback on all of our resources is welcome to contact us in that regard. Nicole?
Thanks for that. And I'm just conscientious of the time. I will try to squeeze in two more questions before I pass it back to you. The question asks, why does the college allow racist posts on their Facebook page? Carol Lang posts about the pandemic on a college post from July 10th, 2020. Why is the college not following their own advice about social media? So we really like to thank the member or the person who brought this to our attention. We have removed that post you flagged and blocked this person from our Facebook page. So thank you for bringing that to our immediate attention. So this question, because it deals with a question specifically of the report that the governance chair provided, can you provide more information on this? Based on the committee's recommendation, council approved that a sortition process be used to populate council. Council also approved an application process for non-council member committees based on a competency profile. So with respect to time, I think it might be very appropriate to ask the chair of the governance committee to give a high level response to that. Tom, just unmute.
Thank you, Nicole, and thank you for the question. The sortition is really a process that is random selection. And so it begins with a random outreach to a statistically significant number of Ontario certified teachers and inquiring of them that, you know, are they interested in serving on their council? And the genesis of this approach is based on the principles that the governance committee discussed when we transitioned from a model of governance that is representative, that is based on an election from certain constituencies like, you know, English Catholic, geographical administration, and so on. Switching from that principle to a regulatory governance. And so by starting out with a sortition process, a random selection, a random invitation, what we're doing is following the principles of ensuring diversity, to ensure that the process is going to be open and transparent, to ensure that it is auditable, to ensure that that there is a competency profile that's provided to potential candidates so that they understand exactly what the role of council is and those skills that might be useful to be successful in that role. And finally, to ensure that it's a process that is auditable to ensure transparency by an outside agency. So I hope that addresses the concern. And if the questioner would like more details, I'd be happy to respond more in writing. Thank you. Thanks for the question.
So thanks for that. And I will pass it back to Chantel for our wrap up.
Thank you, Nicole. So this brings us to the conclusion of this year's annual meeting of members, our virtual meeting. Thank you to everyone for submitting your question in advance. It was very helpful for us to be able to prepare. Again, reiterating, don't hesitate, continue to send your questions and we'll have staff prepare responses and post those to our website, including the ones we've addressed this evening, within hopefully 10 business days. Rest assured that we'll try and address every single question that comes to us. On behalf of Nicole Van Woutenberg, John Hamilton, Tom Potter, Marianne Mawad, and myself, I'd like to thank you for joining us this evening. Please stay safe during these unusual times. Et bon courage tout le monde. Merci, bonne soirée.
Thank you and good evening.